All right. Well, thank you, everyone. Was I going to start this, or this is you, Mark?
I'll jump in with a quick intro for folks. No worries.
I saw the slide. I got excited.
It's all good. I'll just say thank you, all of you out there, for joining us today. And thank you, Alexandra and John, for joining us for today's session, which is Text and Data Mining in the Classroom, Lessons from Wayne State University. Today's session in particular will showcase examples of how to teach text and data mining in the classroom. And I should also mention that our session today is sponsored by ProQuest. I'd also like to say that this is one in a series of sponsored webinars from Choice and ACRL that addresses new ideas and developments of interest to the academic library community. Before we jump into the meat of the presentation today, I'd like to point out just a couple of features of the webinar software. For all of you out there joining us as attendees, please know that you're muted and your cameras are off, so you shouldn't worry about generating noise or feedback or anything like that. We have that all taken care of for you. In the main area of the screen, of course, you can follow along with the presentation materials. And if you have questions for Alexandra or for John, please drop those into that Q&A module. We'll take as many as we can get to at the end of the presentation. Often we have more questions than we can get to. So if we don't get to yours, please don't take it personally. We have an hour and, you know, we have a little flexibility there, but sometimes just the volume of questions is such that we cannot get to all of them. But we would encourage you, as they occur to you, drop them in. And you do have the ability to upvote questions. If you see another question that someone else has asked that you would like to second to hear an answer from, please feel free to use that little thumbs up icon. I should also mention that there is closed captioning available today. You can toggle that on or off using the little CC button on the bottom right corner of your screen. And also note that we are recording today's program and that all of you who registered should receive a follow-up email with a link to that recording. And our speakers today are Alexandra Sarkozy and John Dillon. Alexandra Sarkozy is a science and digital scholarship librarian at Wayne State University. She works with faculty and students to conduct literature searches, teaches database and citation manager best practices, and brings digital humanities tools and techniques to undergraduate and graduate classrooms. She was a member of the first CUNY Digital Humanities Research Institute cohort of community leaders in 2018 and continues to advance teaching and research in digital scholarship. John Dillon, Ph.D., is the text and data mining product manager for TDM Studio at ProQuest. His expertise lies in creating edtech products which focus on data visualization, natural language processing, and data science. He's worked previously as a postdoctoral researcher with the University of Notre Dame, USAID, and IBM Research. John has published research on sentiment analysis, machine learning, and learning analytics. All right. And with that, I will stop talking and turn things over to you, Alexandra.
Thank you, Mark. Wayne State University Libraries began working with ProQuest TDM Studio in 2018 to be a pilot school for the alpha version of the tool. So we worked with ProQuest for librarians to understand the tool and to see and to collect feedback in classroom situations as to how students responded to the tool for improvements, essentially. But as someone who has been trying to incorporate more digital humanities into the classroom at Wayne State, I was really excited to use this tool. Here we go. Moving forward with the slides. So today I wanted to talk about a classroom instruction session that I did from start to finish, where I incorporated the TDM Studio into the classroom to communicate both digital humanities and information literacy concepts to an undergraduate classroom. So the The topics I'll go over are how I approached and communicated with faculty about this tool, about options at Wayne State University for bringing digital humanities to the classroom, how I used the opportunity to come to the classroom to incorporate information literacy framework tenets into a digital humanities intro session, as well as helping students understand and explaining some basics of digital humanities analysis through the visualizations in the tool that the TDM Studio can provide. Because just reading textual descriptions is oftentimes not enough to really clearly communicate just what kind of powerful insights can be gained from some of the techniques that the TDM Studio can perform, like network visualizations, topic modeling, feature analysis, things like that. I'm going to go through an actual classroom session that I did in February 2019, actually my last classroom session before the pandemic. And we'll talk about how I designed the lesson, how it went, student reactions, and the overall classroom experience. And then I'll go over some insights as to what I would change or include next time to improve my own teaching session. So first I wanted to talk about how this came about and how I worked with Dr. Lisa Maruka, who is a faculty member in the English department at Wayne State University. At Wayne State, we have a group called DH at Wayne, which we sometimes jokingly call D hat Wayne, because that's how it looks when the email is spelled out. But I had been working with D hat Wayne to a collective group of faculty from several departments on campus, from English, from history, some folks from library science and information science, who worked together to put on a conference every September on digital humanities, but also to build community and raise the profile of digital humanities on campus and to support each other's work. It's still a somewhat small group. And at that point was only in its second year of existence. So it was still pretty new, but I had met Dr. Maruka and I knew of her interest in text and data mining and in distant reading techniques. And so I approached her to see if she would be interested in having the tool demonstrated in her classrooms to demonstrate some of these techniques to students. And she was really excited about it. We set up a date for the following January for me to come into an undergraduate capstone English class for students would have a writing assignment, a major writing assignment at the end of their undergraduate years. And Dr. Maruka really wanted to use the TDM Studio to introduce students to distant reading research methods, to show them what was possible, the research that had been done, and to use the visualizations to communicate some of the concepts of digital humanities. And when we went back and forth on the readings, Dr. Maruka ended up choosing the reading before class for the students. She didn't want a reading that was too complicated or overwhelming for students or that had too much inside baseball about digital humanities, sort of internal debates and things like that. So that was how this came about, and that was sort of the groundwork that was laid for the class. So we had, when we were designing the session, I looked at the pre-reading that Dr. Maruka had chosen, and it was a very basic textual overview of some distant reading techniques. Now, what I mean by distant reading is analytical techniques applied to a large corpus of work. So as opposed to close reading that is typically done by literature scholars where an individual reads various texts and makes comparisons or draws insights from them, distant reading would be a computer analyzing a large volume of text. So it could be anywhere from 1,000 documents or newspaper articles to 200 books or monographs. It can be anything that you put in your corpus. And so the larger body of work that it's going, the computer is going to distantly read is the corpus. And so this was the reading that the students were expected to do coming into the classroom. And when I was designing the session, I knew that we were going to be focusing on text and data mining, that I was going to be demonstrating the TDM Studio and some of the analyses it was capable of. But I also wanted to incorporate a lot of information literacy concepts into the session, because these are kind of the backbone of the way I do my instruction anyway. And these are always concepts that I want to communicate to students. And what I found was that at an introductory level, just talking about some of the basics of digital humanities research methods really lend themselves to talking about these concepts. Move a little bit closer. So some of the major concepts that that TDM Studio in this session allowed me to communicate was really very much that authority is constructed and contextual. Corpuses are created and chosen. What you tell the computer to analyze is very much a choice, and it affects the outcomes and the insights that the computer is able to come up with, or the analysis that it's able to do, and then a scholar or student can analyze. Research is inquiry. There's a lot of choices and a lot of things that we don't know about the outcome of the research that we're going to do. We put some texts in and we're not sure what's going to come out at the other side of the algorithm. Searching is strategic exploration. The corpuses that are created for ProQuest tool are based on queries of ProQuest full text documents. So depending on your search terms, you can get a very different corpus, and whether you include certain vocabulary words or synonyms is going to change your outcome. So really getting a lot of these concepts integrated into the session was not a difficult ask, and I was really excited about that. And also information creation is a process. Text and data mining is a research method that creates new knowledge, and the creation of this knowledge and any information that we get from the TDM Studio is a process. And it is subject to the same sort of scholarly rigor that we would apply to other scholarly processes. It's not just facts spit out by a machine. And that's something that's really important to communicate, and the source of a lot of confusion when talking about digital humanities, especially in an introductory classroom situation. My goals for the session were to essentially communicate information literacy concepts, to expose students to new research methods and visualization techniques. My goal was not to explain algorithms. It was not to explain the math or the back end, or really having students have a solid understanding of them. I wanted them to be exposed to new ways of understanding literature, and hopefully generate some aha moments. I wasn't sure how it was going to go, but these were the outcomes I had in mind when I was designing the session. So the session was an evening class. There were about 25 students. And so they were tired at the end of the day, but they were interested. And I started off by asking the students about the reading. Did they understand it? Did they have any questions? And most of them did not have an understanding of what the reading was talking about. They had never done these computational analyses themselves. They didn't know what it should look like or even how to evaluate. And And the real power of the TDI Studio, or TDM Studio, I'm sorry, in the classroom is that the visualizations can bring home the concepts so beautifully. So I then launched the tool, and beforehand I had chosen a corpus that was pre-made by ProQuest. All of the corpuses are pre-done because corpuses take a long time to analyze, and it takes a lot of computing power, so they're not done on the fly. But there were a number to choose from that other researchers had created, and I chose LGBTQ plus rights since 1980. And I chose that corpus because I thought it was something that students could relate to in their everyday lives. It didn't require prior background knowledge of any literary period, of any type of politics, of any sort of scholarly background. Even though students were quite young and maybe had not been alive since 1980, chances are they were familiar with some of these debates and knew that LGBTQ plus individuals have been discriminated against for a long time. And this is where I really brought home the concept that corpuses are constructed and selected, because this corpus comes from the New York Times newspaper coverage rather than any other sources. And it's based on certain terms that were in a search query. And all of that is explicitly displayed on the page in the ProQuest TDI Studio. So I was able to explain that maybe something, you know, had we, or just sort of discussed the concept that if this had been a different publication, the coverage might be different. It might focus on arts and culture rather than politics. It might focus on different people, and our output and the output of the tool would be different. This is, we're not generating facts, even though there's numbers involved. This is not the end all be all of the story. And that really highlights the interpretive nature of digital humanities work as a part of literary analysis. The information creation is a process. It undergoes iterations. It undergoes interpretation. Research is inquiry. You have to think critically about all the tools that you use and what goes into your corpus and your choice of analysis. And searching is strategic exploration. And this is a screenshot of the tool. And here we can see that the LGBT plus rights since 1980, there's some details on the right-hand side about the query. There's some research starter questions. And at the bottom, my screen cut off, there is an actual syntactical query that can be replicated. And so in the TDI, Alpha edition that I was using, there were several different methods of analysis that you could apply to the corpus that you chose. And I chose topic modeling because topic modeling is probably the most intuitive text and data mining technique. And it is also one that lends itself to discussion and visualization. So we went ahead and looked at the topics that the tool had created. And we discussed what the topics are, and we looked at their prevalence in the corpus over time. And I'm gonna jump forward to my next screen, which is an actual screenshot of the topics generated. Now, in the number of topics and the number of iterations, these are default settings, and I stuck with those, though those can change and can change the topics that appear and their importance in highlighting in the corpus. But you'll notice I'm not focusing on, okay, kids, topic modeling is, you know, going into bag of words and nearest neighbor and algorithmic talk about creating data out of text. I didn't talk about any of that. I just talked about the topics because my focus was more on getting to these aha moments and demonstrating the strength of the tool. And there's huge bodies of literature on what the actual algorithm and what goes on behind the scenes is for students to explore afterwards, which I'm happy to talk about. Again, I only had an hour. But we see that the first topic is AIDS, disease, virus, health, infected. And for anyone not familiar with topic modeling, what this is, in one sentence, is the algorithm finds documents where these words are likely to be in the same document, or they're likely to be collocated in however you chop up your corpus. And then as we see over here, we see the topic weight over time. We see that these words were used a lot in the mid 80s. And that checks out, you know, that absolutely is when AIDS began to appear as a disease. And it was all about viruses, infections, epidemic. It was about that it was a bloodborne disease and drug, probably referred to drug use. But in the tool, you can click on the peaks here and you can see the actual articles that are generating these peaks. We see, in topic five, we see parade, Hiberians, Irish, Patrick, you know, and again, in the mid 90s, these were some big news events that happened. So we could trace the peak and see what the major topics of conversation in the newspaper and the New York Times in this corpus were. So that was something that the visualization was able to bring home. It was able to explain topic modeling without a huge mathematical discussion, and also to do it in a way that students could understand on subject matter that students could understand. Even though they may not be familiar with the landmark politicians, debates, legislation, things like that. We'd spent a lot of time talking about AIDS and HIV in the 1980s and another big spike. And we see Bill Clinton is the name that appears the most in this entire corpus. And a lot of it was about don't ask, don't tell. His policy of non-disclosure for military personnel regarding homosexuality. And everyone was very concerned about AIDS at that point because this was pre-AZT, pre-treatment. So there's the topics. And then, yeah, here we see there's some topics about Mayor Koch, Mayor Giuliani, Mayor Bloomberg, Clinton's, run up to a presidential campaign. We see that the topics generated by the tool really lined up nicely with our understanding. And that doesn't always happen with text and data mining. This was a really clean example of the way we use really clean searches when we demonstrate databases for searching. And that's why I chose it. So I did raise some discussion students to pair this up with the information literacy. And I asked, how might these topics be represented if they were from a different news source? For instance, a San Francisco newspaper, where in the 80s, 90s, and 2000s, gay culture was much more accepted in the wider culture than it was in New York City. New York City things were still pretty underground, and the New York Times is a very conventional mainstream media source. What if it was from an alt-weekly newspaper? How might the topics differ? Were editorials included in the analysis or not? How might that change the topics that we see? And what can we gather on the New York Times's, always see the typos. What would the New York Times' position on LGBTQ plus rights as an institution be? Can we derive anything from the topics that might tell us where their coverage priorities were and their position as an institution, and did that change over time? And this really shows that authority is constructed and contextual. The New York Times is an authoritative source. It's considered the paper of record and has been for many years. But its authority is constructed and contextual. It chose to pay attention to certain things about LGBTQ plus rights and not about others. And also research is inquiry. We're inquiring. We are doing research using this tool, and we're making inquiries about the tool and about the corpus. So after the discussion, this is where things kind of went off track in a very serendipitous and wonderful way. Dr. Maruka asked me to pull up the 18th century poetry corpus because when I was getting the tool set up, she saw from the dropdown that there was an 18th century poetry corpus created by ProQuest, and that is her area of expertise. And so we were able to do a topic model on that corpus, and Dr. Maruka, with her subject matter expertise, was able to provide some insights. And it was very nice to be able to contrast that corpus with the New York Times corpus so that we can see some differences. You see some differences in the number of spikes and changes over time. You don't have those, you know, big giant peak, don't ask, don't tell. And instead, you see things are a little bit more ambiguous and difficult to understand. And, you know, I don't have the subject background in this. I don't know why it's important that a lot of sea metaphors were used, and this is the biggest topic, though a scholar might know that and be able to determine changes over time and trends in poetry. And so it was really neat to be able to go through the topics like that, even if it wasn't as obvious of an example as the LGBTQ plus rights corpus. And to close the session, I wanted to show some of the additional visualizations the TDM Studio was capable of. And the demonstrations were less in depth and they relied on default settings, but the network visualization will also show people, places, organizations that are mentioned often in the corpus as well as in individual topics. And also geographic analysis to visualize location. That's another really powerful way that digital humanities can really make clear certain things that might be not so obvious for scholars who are just doing close readings of the text. So moving on to student reactions, the students in the class were very interested in the TDM Studio as a tool for literary analysis. You know, the aha moments had happened. There were a lot of cools and kind of murmurs when we started to be able to make the connections between the topics that the TDM tool had generated and actual news events that had happened that students knew about, or that we were able to contextualize in sort of a narrative manner rather than mathematically modeling it through digital humanities. I did offer to students several opportunities to work with me and to work with ProQuest if they had something that they wanted to do for their project. You know, we would be able to create a corpus for them. We would be able to work with them to do the analysis, but I don't know if it was too early in the semester or if they just preferred to just write the essay, but no one contacted me about it after class. And while I didn't do formal assessment on this session, students were participating. They were responding to my questions. And I think that students understood it, though. I didn't do formal assessment. I don't know for sure, but it was a very positive experience for the students and for me. And I wanted to include a few more notes on working with faculty because it can be difficult to get into the classroom in the first place, and it can be difficult to bring digital humanities into a classroom in a tool like this. Not all faculty are on board with computational humanities. Not all faculty have time in their semester for this. But I did, my initial approach was with Dr. Maruka was because I knew that she was interested in this as a research method and as something that she wanted students exposed to. And this was a great way to bring really cool visualizations and understanding to the students in her classroom. And again, this was through the English department. Whereas if I were approaching someone in the history department at Wayne State, while the history department does do some digital humanities, a lot of it focuses on mapping and GIS technologies, rather than topic modeling news sources or literary corpora. I was really trying, my approach is to match instruction opportunities with larger research and instructional goals of faculty members, as well as always taking the opportunity to incorporate the information literacy concepts into the discussion. And then I also asked my colleagues if they knew of other faculty members who've expressed interest in digital humanities or digital methods, because this is an area that the library can bring value to the classroom outside of just citation management software or database searching support or other traditional library concept, library teaching areas. And then some opportunities for improvement. I definitely would have conducted formal assessment. And I wish I had thought to do that. I was not as far along in my own assessment journey to do either, you know, attitude, student perceptions and attitudes assessment, or to even see if any learning took place. But I expect that the assessment would have been positive. Most of our formal assessment comes out pretty positive at the library. I would have made sure I was more familiar with how TDM Studio created the visualizations. Students inevitably did have questions about, what does that number mean? Why is that a 4 in that one? And why is that a 2? What does 0.25 mean? And I am not that familiar with the, you know, the special sauce of how those visualizations are created. And while that didn't hurt my credibility too badly, I did have to say, I don't know, I can't answer that, but I can find out for you. I would have included more demonstration of the network analysis visualization and link it to the topics. I think that there's even more insight and visualization that can happen with advanced use of colors by looking at individuals and organizations and geographic locations to expand the story out. And with that, I've asked that my email be popped in the chat. If anyone would like to reach out to me and talk about bringing introductory DH to the classroom, I'm happy to talk further afterwards, and whether it's using this tool or not, there's a lot of ways that we can do this. And now I'll turn it over to John Dillon, who's going to talk more about the research end of things. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Alexandra. And thanks again for your help with this presentation, and also for your help with the collaboration with Wayne State University, which we had. And it's great to see you all today, or see you all virtually. Again, my name is John Dillon, and I'm the product manager for TDM Studio. And I want to walk through basically two different case studies, two additional case studies, so that in addition to the case study, which we've just heard about, highly successful case study from Alexandra at Wayne State University, just a few other ones so you have a few options on the table of what sort of is possible within this space. And I think there are two key. We've been working with students now, almost 1,000 students at many different universities. And I think there are two key aspects to teaching text and data mining, if we can boil it down to two. One is, and this is a point which Alexandra really hit, one is, what is possible? Show me what is possible. I want to know what is possible. I'm a grad student, I'm an undergrad, I'm a librarian, I'm a faculty member. What is possible? Show me what's possible. And then the other piece is, how do I do this myself? So what is possible and how do I do this myself? And TDM Studio basically has two pieces, and it was designed around these two teaching and learning motivators. So one is the visualization interface on the left there, which Alexandra and her students used at Wayne State in a prototype form. And that basically, no coding needed, push button visualizations, show me what is possible. And then the other, I think, complementary piece is we have Jupyter notebooks, which are paired, which run in a cloud computing environment. And those can be used for how do I do this? So I like those two aspects of it. And I think if I've learned anything about text and data mining, teaching and learning over the last 5 years, it's that those are the two key aspects. So I'm just going to jump to the first of two case studies. So two case studies we're going to blitz through here. The first one is instead of the library going into the classroom, this was an example of the library at the University of Sydney in Australia hosting a two-hour text and data mining seminar. So similar type of engagement, similar size of engagement. Maybe this type of engagement is a little bit smaller, but same thing where it's contained. And the goal is basically with this type of seminar, the goal is to give broad data literacy exposure. And I really like this as an approach for that libraries can take for supporting text and data mining. This was, I think, in 2018, and you can see three fabulous librarians on the screen at the University of Sydney. We have Ryan, Jean, and Kim, and all three worked to put together a workshop which was specifically targeted at graduate students in the humanities. And the goal was, can we give them just a taste of what's possible? So for that first objective, what's possible within text and data mining? And I got to attend the seminar as well. And the objective here was broad introduction to text and data mining for attendees to gain overview. And I think that they succeeded quite well with that objective. Again, it wasn't let's dig in and show you all the nuance of every single text and data mining algorithm, but you could see the students, the graduate students in the workshop, in the seminar, you could see they were already thinking and asking, okay, this is interesting. How can I apply this to my own research? So I think that's the sort of transition piece. First, what is possible? And then there's the aha moment that Alexandra was speaking about, which is I could use this for my own research. And then that shifts into, okay, now show me how to do it. And I think that transitions into coding interface or creating your own data set or corpus as a collection of text documents. So this was a seminar held at the University of Sydney. Improving data literacy offerings from the library was one of the alignment pillars with the university's, I think it had five key missions, and one pillar of it was data literacy. So this was the library also aligning with that pillar. And maybe at your library, you already have conducted this type of workshop, but I think that this type of workshop, 2 hour contained, very clear objective, often aligned with university high level mission, can be a valuable starting point for text and data mining. And I think if you have offered these and they've worked well, we'd love to hear about it in the chat. If you haven't offered them, or you have offered them and they haven't worked well, we'd be thrilled to hear about that as well. So that's sort of the first case study. The first case study was this type of contained seminar. And they introduced similar topics that Alexandra mentioned, topic modeling, geographic analysis. They also talked about network analysis, so key sort of mainstays of text and data mining across the disciplines. And they worked with lots of different content as well. So this is sort of one example. Now, moving ahead here, the second example I want to talk about is if the first one is sort of a small engagement option, this is sort of a medium to medium large engagement option. And in this case, we worked with King's College London, And I worked with Professor Paul Spence, who's the director of Digital Humanities MA program. And basically what we did is we worked to explain and walk through geocoding. So how do you extract and identify locations in text documents? We worked through designing a single class to introduce his master's students to geocoding. So text mining, broad category, subcategory, geocoding. So this was more involved. So what we did for this one is we actually put together pre-reading, similar to the note that Alexandra made. So here we used a sort of canonical text on geographic parsing by Grida. And then the students worked through an exercise. They created a visualization. So they created a geographic visualization around a topic that was of interest to them. And then we also set them up with programmatic or Jupyter Notebook access. So they got to see both show me what it can do. And then also they got to see how does it do it. And that was also the gist of the class. So, and one of the learning objectives that Paul really wanted for the seminar was that I don't just want the students to see what's possible. I also want them to gain one or two steps down into the complexity of how different algorithms make decisions and how that impacts results. So that's, I thought that was really cool and I think really appropriate for this type of master's program. So I'm going to actually, let me actually dig in here. And I'm going to actually share my screen, if you could please help me, Sabrina. And I'm going to show you what we used with the students, just so you have a quick peek of what they saw. So we had a 1-hour class. And first thing we did as part of the pre-prep for the class is all students created a data visualization, a data set. They created a data set that was relevant to their own interest, and it had a geographic dimension to it. So that was the requirement. You can actually see here, just to loop back to Alexandra's presentation, this is the History of Human Rights corpus. This was another corpus that was used alongside the LGBT rights data set in conjunction with it. And basically you had students creating geographic visualizations on topics that were of interest to them. So it could be any sort of topic. This particular one is looking at drinking water and lead, which is interesting. So we started here and we used this for the first half of the class. And we said, okay, what do you notice? Where are most of the points on the map? Where are there not points on the map? Let's open up one of the articles and let's look at the location and see if we can actually find that location in the article. How come it's selecting this Springfield instead of the 50 plus other Springfields in the United States? So this really served as a way of digging into the problem space and beginning to understand some of the challenges of geocoding. I mean, how do you know when it mentions Charlotte, it's a person and not a place? Can be quite challenging. So this was the first half of the class. Students prepared their own data sets, and then they also explored this together in groups in the class. And then the second half, the goal was to say, okay, how is this done? So we set each student up with what's called a workbench access. So this is coding, complete coding access using Jupyter Notebook, open source format used across the notebook, used across the university for supporting data science work. And then what we did is we actually walked students through some of the code. So this is loading the coding interface that the students saw in the classroom. And one of the examples, which we include here, actually tries to extract the locations from the text document. So if we scroll down here, this is pulling out named entities. And then we scroll down here and we specifically select the geographic entities. And then down here, I have a really simple example where I'm loading GeoNames gazetteer or lookup table. And I'm demonstrating how to select the Austin. So there's many places named Austin, and this very simple data frame sort option is selecting the one that's the most, has the most people. So if it mentions Austin, it's always the one in Texas, and it's never the one in Minnesota if you select by population. So just walking through very simple population-based algorithm selection for geocoding and giving the students the next stepping stones into, okay, I could do this. I could rerun the sample code from TDM Studio, or I could improve the algorithm and run it another way. So this was the second piece of the class. And I'm just gonna stop sharing there. And then Sabrina, if you could please help me with the slides. Thank you very much. And let me grab here. Yeah, and that's pretty much all. So the payoff, I think, of the second learning case, the medium-sized learning teaching and learning example, was an intermediate understanding of geocoding by the end of the unit. So pretty impressive that the students were able to, within the course of a pre-reading exercise and a class session, gain a decent understanding, I think, maybe even an advanced understanding of what geocoding is and what you can do with it. And those are the sort of two examples. So now we kind of had three examples on the table here. One from Wayne State University that Alexandra very kindly walked through, and then two other ones, one from Sydney and one from King's College London. And that's pretty much all I have. I have a slide if you're interested in learning more about TDM Studio, but if it's okay with you all, let's open it up for questions, please.
Excellent. All right. Thank you, John, and thank you, Alexandra. We have several questions in the hopper already. And I would just encourage folks, if you do have questions for either of our speakers today, please feel free to drop those right in that Q&A module. There should be a few that you can see that have been answered there in that answered tab. So we'll just point that out for folks out there if you want to take a look through those. We got also several questions here. Let's maybe just to get this out there a little more directly. I know that it was mentioned briefly in the presentation, but could you define corpus for folks that may not be familiar with that?
You go ahead, Alexandra.
I was about to say you go ahead, John. A corpus is, it's the documents that you're running the algorithm across. So for the LGBTQ corpus, it was a set of search results from the New York Times that mentioned certain words, from 1980 to 2000. So there were about, I think, 2,600 articles in that corpus. So the corpus is all of those documents. And then depending on how you kind of chop it up, which is sort of an intermediary step, you'd have a certain number of documents in there, but the corpus is everything in there. So it would be a different corpus if we included New York Times and San Francisco Chronicle. And that would be a different corpus. But the corpus is just the primary texts that you're analyzing. And a corpus can be anything. It can be, there are corpuses of Project Gutenberg books. You can make a Jane Austen corpus. You can have languages, non-English language corpuses. It's anything you want the computer to analyze. Does that answer the question?
That gives a pretty good idea of what the corpus is. If folks have additional questions on it, they can always drop them in. And again, I think this may have been touched on a little bit in the presentation, but I would throw this over maybe to you, John. We've had some questions about where the corpuses come from, how they're created, and all that sort of stuff. Could you address that a little bit?
Yeah, absolutely. It's a great question. So it's interesting, initially, as Alexandra pointed out in her presentation, initially we worked quite closely with librarians and faculty when we were piloting this solution, and we would make the corpus, all the data sets or corpora come from ProQuest content. So lots and lots of ProQuest content, especially newspaper content. And initially it did take a long time because the researchers would say, hey, I want this, and then we would make it. And then the teaching and learning librarian specialist would say, no, I want this, then we would make this, and it would be very iterative. But now all of that has been built into the production version, and it's primarily quite similar to a search engine where you use searches, you select publications, and you can create your own data set. And then we run it automatically with different topic modeling and geographic algorithms, soon to be sentiment analysis as well. So it's a great question.
Excellent, thank you. Douglas here asks, pretty straightforwardly, how do I get access to TDM Studio?
I can help with that. So the email address, which we briefly had on the screen, if you send us an email, tdmstudio@proquest.com, we can set you up with the solution. We also offer trials as well. Trial can be very viable, a free trial. Free trial is viable when you have a project that's interested or a class that's interested.
Great, so I just dropped that into the chat there for folks if they would like to access that. All right, we've got lots of questions here, just sort of looking through them.
Some of them I answered, but you know, I know that John would have other insights into the questions and could talk further about what I said in the text answer. I just wanted to make sure that they got addressed.
So maybe let's take some of those. Absolutely. So, and maybe I'll throw this out to you, actually, to you, Alexandra, before we move it over to John. We did have a comment, really, from Nicola, who says, I'm thinking this would have applications for DEI, being diversity, equity, and inclusion-oriented research. And I just wonder what sort of possibilities you see there, what if you have any thoughts on some of the directions there or anything like that.
John mentioned that there's a sentiment analysis capability for the TDM Studio. And I think looking historically about how traditionally marginalized populations are talked about in the news, looking at the topics of coverage, I mean, this isn't not just historical. I read my local paper and, you know, a lot of focus on crime, you know, not a lot of focus on good things happening in the community. You can look at, you know, you can really visualize and bring home how these are occurring in news coverage. You can look at analyze political documents this way. You can also look at maybe metaphors that come up, you know, language choices, changes in the way we talk about different groups and policies. Dog whistles could come up as a topic, you know, maybe one that wasn't as obvious, you know, to someone manually reading 1,000 newspaper articles that a tool could help to surface. Those are some possibilities I see.
Excellent, thank you. We've got a question here for John from Douglas, and John says, are there tutorials that demonstrate the same case study in both the push button interface and the Python R Jupyter notebooks. So the sort of thing that would allow students to move sort of from one to the other and see how it works?
Yeah, it's a great question. And the short answer is we're trying to build that bridge. So we're getting there, but we're not there yet. We have the two pieces. We have the sort of the two pieces built, and we have extensive documentation for each of the visualization methods, which I think is critical for transparency. But it would be great. And we are working towards having the type of tutorial, which will show you, okay, this is the what can you do? And this is how do you do it? So not yet, but we're heading that way. It's thanks again, Douglas, for the question. It's a great one.
Yeah, in the works. Great, great. And so we've got another question here from Shalini, who says, this is about the data set. Does it automatically convert HTML files to text, and can it read and analyze Excel or CSV or other file types?
So I'll just jump in here. On the visualization side of the solution, the visualization side all works with only ProQuest content, but the ProQuest content universe is pretty vast. So all of that content is in XML, and it works seamlessly because we have full control over the input XML structure. On the other side, the coding side, you can bring in content in any type of format you want. You can then also mix it with our XML text data that you have access to within the studio, and you can produce any type of results you would like. The only requirement on the coding side is that users need to know Python or R. So that's just an important note. Good question. Thanks.
Okay. Great. And this is, I think, related to what you were just saying. But so it sounds to me like Nicola is asking, can non-ProQuest data be uploaded into here? For example, for the nursing PhD program, use of Medline or Science Direct or that sort of thing. Can you do those sorts of uploads in there?
Yeah, another great question. So on the coding side, absolutely you can. On the visualization side, still only working with ProQuest content. Again, though, pretty much anything within the ProQuest universe is available that's also on the ProQuest platform. So you know, newspaper content, dissertation content, scholarly journals, primary sources, literary works like Literature Online that Alexandra was demonstrating from.
Yeah, so even on the using the ProQuest stuff, a huge amount of stuff that you can work with. Yeah.
Huge. Yeah.
Excellent. Just giving folks another minute or two to add any last questions that they may have. And of course, if either of you see any questions that we haven't gotten to that you know think would be good, just let me know. And so we have a question that you spoke to or that you typed out an answer to, Alexandra, but it might be interesting to just, you know, address here for the recording. And I apologize. I'm not going to get the acronym or the initialism here correct. I'm not sure exactly what it is. But Douglas asks, for Alexandra, it looks as if this BI addressed at least four threshold concepts in the framework. Did you have specific learning outcomes for each of them?
I think the BI stands for bibliographic instruction. what librarians bring to college and classrooms. And you know, the term is telling and bibliographic instruction, where we explain how to properly cite research and sources and how to find them. But librarians have moved beyond that, as Douglas indicated, into information literacy and threshold concepts that we want to communicate to students. And I answered in the chat, no, I didn't write out learning outcomes, but I knew what I was looking for in student responses. And if I didn't get it from the students, I was going to hammer it home and tell them the answer. Yes, it's going to change if you add more sources. Yes, it's constructed. You know, I said it, but I tried to show it as well. And again, I didn't do assessment of any learning outcomes either, which I always hesitate to do because not everybody takes away what you want them to take away. And what I wanted them to take away is that this is a new cool thing that you can think about. That's, you know, that's like some sessions, I'm happy if they take away my name and that the library exists. For this one, it was very introductory, but I think that they did take, you know, depending on the student, they could have taken away a very sophisticated understanding. So I hope that answers the question.
Absolutely. And thanks for answering it twice. We appreciate it. All right. Looking at the time, we've come up to the end of the hour. So I'll just take a second here to say thank you so much, Alexandra and John, for taking the time to walk us through this tool and to show us the use cases. So it's really cool stuff. Really neat to look into a corpus of literature and see what comes out. I would also just take a minute.
Thank you as well, Mark.
Yeah, happy to do it.
Thank you.
I would also say thanks to everybody out there for joining us. We appreciate your taking the time to do so. Just a quick reminder that we did record the program today. So you should get an email with a link to the recording within about 24 hours. And as we sign out here, if you have just a minute or two to give us a couple of responses to a very brief survey that should pop up in your browser, we would really appreciate that. Thanks again to everyone out there for joining us. We hope you will join us again in the near future on another program. Thanks very much.